Sensational Horse Hall. Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading comes from the second book of 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verses 10 through 17. It can be found on page 646 of your Pew Bibles. Listen now to the word of God. You, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, at Iconia, and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured. Yet from them all, the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and apostates will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue with what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work.
You may be seated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much that you are our God, that you love us, that you're working in us, that you want to work through us. Lord God, we ask that you would be embracing us with your love. That, Lord, as we go through difficult times, as we go through persecution, as we go through trials, that we would turn in towards you and look at it as an opportunity to grow deeper in our relationship with you, rather than a trial to be overcome or something that puts distance between us and you. Lord God, we love you so much. We want to experience your love in amazing and profound ways. Lord, help us in the good times and the bad times and everything in between to say, I will choose to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. In our culture, we really don't like to talk about suffering, unless we're complaining about it. We certainly don't like to talk about the fact that suffering is actually evidence that you are a Bible-believing Christian, that you are a Bible-following Christian, that you are a follower of Jesus and a lover of people. Suffering is an aspect that often gets glossed over for those of us who are Christians. We live in one of the greatest countries that this world has ever seen, during one of the greatest and most affluent times that the world has ever seen. Yet because we live in such a time of wealth and prosperity, our culture, our country, and our time can actually be a spiritual danger to us. Because if we seek comfort over godliness, we'll miss what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Most of us have, at some point in time or another, been lulled into complacency because we have been blessed and we have so many more opportunities than so many people, even throughout our country, certainly throughout the world and definitely throughout time. We have so many opportunities, we get lulled into complacency because it becomes about success. It becomes about comfort for us. Life becomes about succeeding in the world's eyes. For many of us, myself included, we have taken the idea of chasing life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness far more seriously than we have embodied making disciples of all nations. And so one of the questions that we must answer this morning is, are you, am I, more of a happiness pursuer or more of a disciple or a follower of Jesus, lover of people? Do you get more excited about the freedoms that you have as an American, or more excited about the freedoms that you have as a follower of Jesus? Where is your priority? Do you honor America more, or do you honor Jesus more? I'm not saying don't honor America. I'm saying Jesus needs to be honored so much higher than any earthly freedom that we could ever have. Jesus should be honored because he doesn't just give us freedoms for the next 20, 30, 40, 50 years. Instead, he gives us freedom for all of eternity. He sets us free. He gives us true life in a way that no earthly savior could ever have. Whenever we are more concerned with comfort than we are concerned with obedience to Christ, we are in the process of rejecting Scripture and rejecting Jesus. When comfort is a high priority, we are saying, no, I don't want to listen to those scripture passages about suffering. We are saying, I don't want to follow Jesus and pick up my cross daily. The Christian life is not a life about comfort. It is a life about abundance. It is about being so overjoyed in who Jesus is and what he has done that we get to move forward. We get to bless others. We get to show people the love of Jesus. And for far too many of us, myself definitely included, life becomes much more about maintaining the status quo, maintaining as much comfort as we possibly can, getting the best things that we could possibly want, keeping up with the Joneses. And that's not what the Christian life is about. The Christian life is about service. The Christian life is about showing the love that Jesus has shown us. And when we choose to pursue comfort over obedience, then we're saying, God, I don't like you. I don't like your scripture. Get in line and be my genie. Give me the things I want. As we look at today's passage, I'm struck by some of Paul's claims. And I'm struck also by how much Timothy knows Paul. Yes, Paul has mentored him. Yes, Paul has invested him. But Timothy knows the ins and outs of Paul's ministry. He knows Paul's ministry in a way that's greater than many of us know our favorite athletes or our favorite sports teams. Timothy knows Paul's highlights, slumps, and injuries. Timothy had a better idea of what was going on in Paul's missionary journeys than any of us can explain how the World Series champions, the Chicago Cubs, have gone from one-year World Series champions to the next year barely being able to stay at or above the 500 mark. Granted, they had a little bit of a streak this week after I wrote that line. But Timothy knew the history of Paul's ministry. In Lystra, Paul was stoned and left for dead. People actually gathered rocks and tried to kill him. Once they thought he was dead, they left. Then Paul, instead of saying, "This ministry thing's for the birds," he got up and kept preaching. Verse 12 makes a bold statement that I believe should be a challenge for each and every one of us in this room. Each and every one of us who claim to be a follower of Jesus, who say, "Jesus is my Savior and my Lord." And it should challenge us to ask, are we really following Jesus? Here's what it says. "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." Paul doesn't say that some will be persecuted. He doesn't say that most who live a godly life will be persecuted. He says all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. If you are a follower of Jesus and have not endured any type of persecution in your life, you might not be a follower of Jesus. You may know all the true things, but if it has not changed into a lifestyle action where things have gotten difficult for you at times because you're a follower of Jesus, not just because you're a human and things happen to you, but if things have not gotten difficult for you to remain a follower of Jesus, or because you are a follower of Jesus, then we have some serious soul searching. We have to ask ourselves, have we accepted Jesus as our Savior but not our Lord? And the difference is, a Savior is someone who swoops in and saves us. The Lord is someone that we follow and we say, "Yes, sir, I will do whatever you ask." And for many of us, we've chosen for Jesus to be our Savior and the American dream to be our Lord. Have you experienced persecution for your faith? Or you keep experiencing comfort because you have more in common with the culture around us than you do with the culture of Christ followers? Notice I said Christ followers. I didn't say churchgoers. I didn't say church members. I said Christ followers. Because there's a different culture among those who follow Jesus than those who simply plaster the name Christian on top of it. Based on these passages, people who want to be followers of Jesus will suffer. It's not even talking about people who are successfully followers of Jesus. People who want to be followers of Jesus. And that, if that is the case, then we've got to ask the other flip side of the coin, what happens to evil people? What happens to people who pretend to be Christians rather than those who are actually followers of Jesus? Verse 13 answers this question. While evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived, imposters will keep getting worse, and they will keep deceiving people. They will keep deceiving themselves, telling themselves, I'm a good Christian. They will keep deceiving others, and others will believe that they're good Christians. And when it comes down to it, Jesus tells us that we will know each other by our love for one another. Do the Christians you respect and admire love other Christians? Do the Christians you know and admire sacrifice for Jesus during the hard times? Do the people that you and I love and admire, do they follow Jesus, or do they just keep on doing self-promotion or letting other people talk about how it is? I think one of the dangers for us as Christians is to allow ourselves to be deceived by our own mind. The biggest backsliding that I see in Christians is not from the new believers who don't know enough. It's from the believers who have been seasoned believers for a long time, who know more than enough. But it doesn't translate into action. It doesn't translate into a continual growth mindset. It translates this type of imposter behavior translates into us looking back on what we have done in the past, not what Christ is doing. If the people you admire most in the Christian faith haven't done anything really godly for the last 10 years, then they're not really godly anymore. God keeps working on true Christians. When it comes to non-believers and faith believers, it seems as though everything falls into place for them a lot of times. But one of the ways that we can tell the difference between an imposter and a real believer is whether or not they keep on coming. Do they apologize? Do they repent? Do they keep striving to do better? Especially during hard times. Sometimes God gives us the opportunity to follow Him in the midst of trials and pain, and our response, rather than following Him, is to flake out. I want you to know that it has been a temptation for me to get lost in the grief of losing my grandfather. It has been a temptation for me to give up. It has been a temptation to leave and not help you, God's church, finish well when accusations have been made against me. But God keeps pushing me out of my comfort zone, challenging me to finish well. In a Christian life, it's not about how you start, it's how you finish. Are you finishing your Christian walk? Are you finishing this season of your Christian walk well? When you lose someone you love, or hit a difficult time in your life, you will be given an opportunity to show if your faith is truly genuine or not. Do you bail? Or do you dive wholeheartedly into Jesus during times of suffering? Most of us in this room have a similar story to Timothy. We've been raised around the truth of Scripture, and at some point, our faith became our own rather than something that was just culturally passed on from our parents, even intentionally passed on from our parents. At some point, that faith had to become our own and not just riding on our parents' coattails. It is the Bible that God uses most clearly to help us see the world the way that He sees it. It is through His Scripture that we are best able to recognize that we are in need of a Savior. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. I want you also to know that we need a Savior, not only just a Savior, but a Savior from the fires of hell. We need that. But we need a Savior who promises to be our strength during the hard times. And we need to give ourselves over to that Savior during the hard times. Jesus is God eternal, who created the heavens and the earth. He came as the man Christ Jesus to restore us fallen, sinful human beings into right relationship. By dying on the cross in our place, He is and was the perfect substitute for the punishment that we deserve, because He is perfect. Jesus was buried and rose from the grave after He died so that we could know that death has been defeated on our behalf. He has gone back to heaven so that we can know that our eternal resting place is with Him forever in heaven, if our faith and trust is in Him, if He is our Savior and our Lord. So if the Bible is what God uses to draw us back into relationship with Him, what do we believe about the Bible? Verses 16 and 17 break it down for us. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. The Bible is the Word of God. If we are disciples of Jesus, we do not get to pick and choose which scriptures to agree with. Instead, we know that the Holy Spirit leads us in interaction with Scripture, and that is the way God chooses to remake us, to transform our minds, so that we look more like Him. The goal of Scripture is not to be able to win a Bible quiz event. It's not to have people impressed with us. Scripture exists to help you become a person of God who is competent and equipped for every good work that God has for you, that God has prepared beforehand for you. And that's even during the tough times. Scripture is equipping you to look more like Jesus, to be more like Jesus. So how do you interact with Scripture? do you spend your time arguing your viewpoint or letting Scripture inform your worldviews? Is the Bible a bunch of facts for you to cram into your head, or is it equipping you to actively follow Jesus and love Him? As you decide where and how you will worship next, which books you will read, which preachers you will listen to, and which Christian friends you keep around you, look for people that both believe the truth of Scripture and teach the Bible in such a way that it challenges and equips you and others to follow Jesus and love Him. It's not about behavior modification. It's being about being so overwhelmed by the love of Jesus that you have internal heart transformation and you are no longer the person that you used to be, but instead you are an effective representative of Jesus Christ and His love to you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank You so much for loving us. We ask that You would continue to work in us, that You would continue to change and transform us. Lord Jesus, we ask that You would give us strength and a desire to follow You during the hard times, during the persecution, during the oppression. Lord, let us finish strong as we know Your true believers will finish strong by Your strength. In Jesus' name, amen.